Welcome to Olympic Magazine and the story of the greatest Olympic team of all time. In 1992, the arrival of the US Dream Team was the big event of the Barcelona Olympics. For the first time, the world would see the very best basketball players on earth, the pick of the bunch from the American Super League, the NBA, made possible when the International Olympic Committee opened up the games to professionals. For basketball, it was a huge opportunity. The Secretary General of the International Federation was Boris Stankovic. In the 1980s, the International Federation and the world of sport started to think about putting an end to the hypocrisy that existed in sport at that time. That's to say, there were so-called amateurs who were given money under the table and could take part in all official competitions of the FIBA and even the Olympic Games. While on the other side, there were professional leagues, professional players with professional contracts who were excluded from our movement. The idea was to bring together all basketball players of the world and give them the opportunity to take part in the most important competitions, like the World Championships and the Olympic Games.
He came to our office in, I think it was 85 or 86, and suggested that the NBA and FIBA should begin a collaboration to develop the sport of basketball. Stankovic was quite simple and direct. He said it doesn't make any sense for FIBA to be involved with all of the basketball players in the world except the best 350. The only way for the world to get better was to include the relationship with the NBA, and we began that kind of collaboration.
David Stern was the other architect of the Dream Team, a visionary who dreamt of globalizing the NBA through television. Stern banked on the Olympic Games as a way of spreading the word. David Stern perfectly understood that the participation of the world's best players, this Dream Team, in the Olympic Games represented the introduction of professional basketball and of the NBA tournament to countries all over Europe and around the world. David Stern's goal was to charm the world, to sell his sport for all it was worth.
The decision was made to go with the 11 best and most decorated players in the NBA at that time. I mean, think about it, Michael Jordan, you have Magic and Larry, you have Patrick at the center with David Robinson. It was an incredible team. I think we'll never be able to duplicate it in terms of the prior achievements of the players. And at the same time, we managed to span sort of generations. 10 years ago, so Malone and Stockton and Magic and Larry, you know, Malone and Stockton were young. Charles was someplace in the middle together with David Robinson and others. They were the best rebounders, the best shooters, the best playmakers, the most experienced competitors. This was sending men in instead of boys. And they demonstrated their superiority.
Sir David Stern was lucky. He was able to call on an exceptional generation of basketball players. The rivalry between Larry Bird and Magic Johnson had caught the imagination of the American people and rekindled their interest in basketball. And the arrival of Michael Jordan brought in more fans with his breathtaking style, defying the laws of gravity almost. Between them, the three greatest players in the history of the game. They would form the core of an incredible squad. The Dream Team was born.
When they said they were going to assemble the best players in the world, I like to think that I was a part of that team. And I never had the opportunity to play with Larry Bird. Never had the opportunity to play with Magic Johnson, you know, Karl Malone, Charles Barkley. Pip is my teammate. To me, the reason I played, yes, to represent, you know, my country, but also to see and compare my skills, my practice habits, and my thought process with some of the best athletes.
I didn't think my basketball career would be complete without a gold medal. And then when the chance came back around in 92 to play on the Dream Team, I couldn't pass up that opportunity. It was the greatest moment of my life. I had so much fun, so many different life experiences, as well as basketball experiences, that I often talk about even today. Also, understanding to be a part of that, you go down in history. See, you're a part of history that you get to put your jersey on that mantle and hang it up in your den or your room, and man, tell your kids, hey, Daddy played for the United States, the Olympic team, I played with such and such, and we won the games, and we had a good time. And your son or daughter will remember that for her life as well.
The Dream Team would restore the nation's pride. Back in 1972, the Soviet Union had put an end to American invincibility. And more humiliation for the amateur university players in 1988 dispelled any lingering illusions of dominance. In 1988, they lost the Olympic Games in Seoul decisively, and that was the best American university team that they could put out. Public opinion changed in the United States and started to attack the Federation and attack basketball as a whole. They asked themselves, how is it possible? The sport that we invented, the sport that we'd always been the best in, and here we are losing at the Olympic Games. Well, that's how the idea of sending the best American players to the Olympic Games was born. This was the famous Dream Team.
We lost in 88, and we wanted to showcase our power that, you know, even though you beat our college players, you can't compete with the NBA players. So we went in, and it was an overkill.
When the Dream Team arrived in Barcelona, mass hysteria was at such a pitch that the organizers had to rethink their security arrangements.
Yeah, that was kind of surprising. I mean, you know, to have the helicopters following and the motorcycles and the motor brigade and everything. I think people were astounded by how you can put together 12 great basketball players and see them all together, see them all at once. It was a show. It was like, you know, traveling with 12 rock stars.
There must have been 30 to 50,000 people in the streets cheering as our bus was on his way to the arena to play the game. And they were not from the United States. They were just excited to have the best basketball players in the world be in their country.
For the first time in the modern Olympics, a team was in the limelight rather than individual swimmers or gymnasts or weightlifters. And during the opening ceremony, the focus turned particularly on one man, Irwin Magic Johnson.
The opening ceremony was probably the highlight of everything, because we were all dressed in blue and white with the red and white and blue ties, and then we all had the cool hats on, the white hats, and walking into the stadium as the United States with all the other athletes, not just the Dream Team, but all the athletes, was an incredible moment.
During that opening ceremony, Magic Johnson was confronting the terrible personal tragedy that he'd revealed to the world only months earlier. He was HIV positive.
I think sometimes we think, well, only gay people can get it, it's not going to happen to me. And here I am saying that it can happen to anybody, even me, Magic Johnson, it can happen.
When Johnson had revealed his condition, his life turned upside down, but he was determined to fight against his disease and against prejudice.
Working hard to try to stop the discrimination against people who have HIV and AIDS.
I think there was an opportunity here to educate the world a little bit on HIV, that you can't transmit HIV virus by playing basketball, and that you can't, and that playing athletics does not hurt you if you're HIV positive. In fact, it may help you. And so actually magic became a lesson to the world in a very constructive way.
Accepting magic was one of the great victories of the U.S. Dream Team.
I had no problem playing against the Magic. And I don't think some of any of those other teams, I think Australia's the only team that said something. But we were with them every day, and we had no problem with it.
So Johnson was a central figure in the team that set out to crush their opponents in Barcelona. Their first game was against the Angolans, who knew they had no chance of victory. And the Americans made no concessions. The score was 116 to 48.
My attitude was to go out and crush them. It wasn't about them being close. We didn't want any close games. We wanted to go out and just put it to them to really show them that we were the world's best.
Their second opponents were Croatia. The Croatians were the best in Europe, but they went down by 33 points, 103 to 70.
It's okay. But I felt like, and I think the guys on the Dream Team felt like, man, when you put that USA on, we had already figured out if we had lost, it would have been the most humiliating upset in sports history. So that's the reason we had such a keen interest.
Against Germany, the difference was even larger, 111 to 68, a 43-point gap in favor of the United States, as the Dream Team swept away any doubts about them.
Most people said before we started the Olympics, we remember this because we always used to talk about this, they won't play together. They won't play together. Too many egos, too many stars. And we made a point to just play together and put on a show that people would never forget. And even today, they still talk about that team today, right now.
I think you just saw guys just trying to blend in. No one wanted to stand above, because everybody's, been in that elite status for some time. So I don't think anyone needed the publicity, for me personally. I didn't want to feel like I was above Magic Johnson, Larry Bird, or Scottie Pippen, even my teammate, David Robinson. I just wanted to fit in and understand what it felt like to be one of 12, not the one of 12 or the two of 12. But one of 12. And it was easy. It was easy because everybody else had the same thought process.
Well, because I think we had one goal in mind. That was to win the gold medal for the United States. I mean, we could, like I said, we could all went our own directions, but we decided from day one that we were going to make this thing work together.
And so they did. Next, taking out Brazil by 127 to 83. But apart from wanting the Olympic title, the players were motivated by another competition, the one between themselves, even during practice.
Competitive nature was unbelievable. I mean, you felt like it was a championship every day, every practice. A lot of trash talking, one-upmanship every day. And if you lost, you heard lip. You heard lip from that day. You had bragging rights going into the next day, which in essence was bragging rights and motivation for the next practice. So the next practice was probably harder than the practice before. It kept escalating to get better and better.
So there was really no time for you to relax or become complacent, because the other guy would kick your butt. And it was that's probably was the best thing.
For Michael Jordan, those practice sessions were very revealing.
It's the day I understood I belong in terms of the best in the world, you know, because all the guys who, you know, was on the same level or above, I got the chance to see and understand and believe that, hey, you know, I deserve to be on that level, you know. And up until that point, it was what every other opinion mattered or said. During that summer, I understood that I belonged in that group. I mean, I had my Olympic experience just by playing the practices, you know. It was more a formality just going through the Olympics because I met the best players and played against the best players in the world. Everybody else was second best. You know, after we broke up from a practice and we put on a uniform to go against another team. You know, that's a highlight of my career. It always will be.
Next up for the Americans, the host nation, Spain. Their approach to the game was clear from the start. They were going to try and enjoy themselves. We knew that we would lose the game, of course. Antonio Díaz Miguel, the trainer, had told us that we were going there for fun. And the game was mainly for fun and for pleasure, certainly. We weren't going out to constrain the Americans or to use tactics to prevent such players from shooting and so on. It was meant to be fun, for the public to have a good time and for us to enjoy the confrontation. As with the other teams, the Spaniards seemed dazzled, though, almost paralyzed by the thought of the opposition. When I scored for the first time, I told myself, wow, I've scored against the dream team.
Really, it wasn't like games because the guys are playing in admiration. You know, it was tough. It wasn't hard to intimidate. The whole intimidation factor was gone.
It finished 122-81 to the United States. The Spanish spectators booed their team, while the Americans showed grace and compassion. At the end of the game and throughout those Olympic Games, in fact, we didn't play a big part, and the spectators were not very happy. People were very critical of Antonio Díaz Miguel, and he was very sad. Well, at that moment, Michael Jordan took him in his arms and accompanied him to the locker room. The people stopped shouting. It really was a gesture of a great champion. They behaved in a perfect manner. We were worried because professionals didn't have a very good image at that time, but the NBA players behaved perfectly, both inside and outside the arena. They were nice to everybody. They were nice to the press, and they showed that great stars who earn millions and millions can also play in the Olympic Games and present this sport in a great way.
La presse, ils ont montré que les grands stars qui gagnent des millions et des millions peuvent aussi jouer aux Jeux Olympiques et présenter son sport d'une manière formidable.
In 1992, more than 9,000 athletes took part in the Olympic Games, among them the Dazzling Dozen, the American basketball squad.
We didn't just hang out with the Dream Team. You know, we went to boxing, we went to women's basketball, we saw some swimming. I mean, we went to some of the different events.
You could meet all the other athletes that you've always wanted to meet, whether it's the boxers, track and field, and I tell you, from that moment, we went to a couple track and field events to see 100,000 people in our outdoor stadium watching the 100-yard dash was an incredible day for us.
During those Olympic Games, the American basketball players behaved like normal athletes, up to a point. It would have been perfect if they'd stayed in the Olympic Village, if they'd eaten the same food and been to the same places as everybody else. But we can understand why they didn't. Everybody would have pestered them. They're famous, and everybody would have asked for autographs.
We had a whole hotel by ourselves, you know. I think a lot of the guys would have loved to stay in the Village, but it was virtually impossible from a security standpoint.
We could, they told us we couldn't go out. So they built us like a little room where we could have fun. So everybody had their family and friends. So we had to mesh and bond. That was the thing. I mean, we spent a lot of time together. And you got to know guys' personality. And that was fun. The plane trips to Spain, to Monte Carlo, there eight or so hours. We got a lot of time practicing every day. I mean, you have to develop these friendships.
The closeness of the Americans was strengthened thanks to their isolation from the other teams.
I never spent a lot of time with Michael Jordan, but at the Olympics, we played cards every night. So now I got a chance to know Michael Jordan, he got a chance to know me. As well as Charles Barkley played up until, you know, we ran him away because he couldn't play that well. And Scottie Pippen, the same thing. We stayed up to 6 a.m. every morning playing cards and just laughing. And then other friendships came about. Patrick Ewing and Larry Bird were inseparable. And it's the greatest feeling. And then you get to know their families, their kids, because we all had our wives and our kids there. And we had a ball. Oh my goodness. The guys don't understand. If you go, you're gonna have so much fun with each other. Man, we ran around all day with one another. They playing golf. I don't play golf, but I was riding them in the cart. I'm driving, and Michael and David and all of them are playing. And then we go, let's go to dinner. We go to dinner. Then they had a room for us so we could play pool and we could socialize. We could play a lot of games. So we were just hanging out. What time you gonna be down there? I see you. And on the bus, we were talking trash so much, just having fun. Remember the times that we crossed each other, like, oh, I broke your ankle on this play, and the whole bus starts laughing. Then you come back on him, and it was just a lot of fun. And we had one goal, and that goal was to win the gold medal. It was the most incredible couple of months of my life.
Number 15, Irvin Magic Johnson.
When Puerto Rico succumbed 115-77 in the quarterfinals, the U.S. had played six games and won six by an average of 40 points. In the semis, Lithuania provided the whipping boys, in spite of the presence of the giant Arvydas Sabonis. The games had become something of a ritual for the American team, a demonstration of their talent. Sometimes it seemed almost surreal.
We were beating teams by 40 and 50. We would follow a guy. He would run to the bench, get the camera, and stand out on the court and take pictures with us while the game is going on. Or he, Magic, followed me. Did you get that on tape? Did you get that on tape? You know, it was, oh man, I tell you, yeah, we had a great time, a great time.
127-76, Lithuania were out, and the Americans, the dream team, were in the final. The 8th of August, 1992 was the date for Croatia. It was an opportunity to meet their opponents for the second time, and this time at least, the Croatians knew what to expect. Moreover, they had one or two in their own team who'd played in the NBA. Nevertheless, there was quite a surprise in the first half as the dream team found itself trailing for the first time since its creation. Once we were ahead, and it was like everybody was going to fall on us. In the 15th minute of the first half, we were ahead, but they recovered very quickly and put things in order. Inevitably, the American machine started up. Jack Nicholson amongst those watching. The game finished, Croatia 85, the United States 117. A joy to watch. As predicted, the American team won by a distance. Across the tournament as a whole, the winning margin was 40 points. On the 8th of August, 1992, the United States were back on top of the world.
When I was up on the podium and they were coming to put the gold medal around my neck, I mean, every emotion just came out. And then Charles was right next to me. And to see him, Barkley, be so excited too. We both just hugged each other, and I think we both shed a tear. You know, it's just, you just get overcome with emotions because you know that you have represented your country, you've represented yourself, you represented your team that you played for, the Lakers, Los Angeles, the community. And to see those people stand up and give us an ovation for at least 5 or 10 minutes to say thank you for a week or two of great and excellent basketball. I mean, it's just like, whew. And you've been together for the last, 2 months working for this goal, and it's finally there, and you finally have achieved it. And for me, that was it. That was the highest level, you know, and again, I'll never, ever forget that moment.
That outfit of 92 was as good as it gets. The real deal, the Dream Team.
But that team had everything we needed. We had size, we had speed, we had strength, we had quickness. Myself, Michael, Karl Malone, John Stockton, Scott, we were all at like peak.
We just played, and I say it's the best basketball I've ever played with those 12 individuals. And I don't think in my lifetime I've ever or ever will play at that highest level with the best competition ever on the basketball court. Ever since Monte Carlo, or even with the Dream Team, you'll never have that type of a talent on the floor at one time in practice. Never again.
After the Dream Team, American invincibility would last 10 years. Counting the World Championships and the Olympic Games, the United States won 58 straight times. The series of victories ended during the last World Championships in 2002, to the great displeasure of the keepers of the American dream.
For whatever reason, it wasn't our best 12, you know, and unfortunately, I still think we should have won, but obviously, you know, when you're competing at this level and everybody's critiquing basketball as a whole, the best basketball players in the world, you need your best basketball players representing your country.
Players in those countries think they have an opportunity to upset the Olympic team in 2004. I say that's good because I know we're the best. The players in the NBA know we're the best, but we just got to go out and, on the court and prove that. And we will. Even right now at 43, if they came up 2 players short, I would commit. And I'll get Michael to commit.